Yes, good morning and welcome to Ireland AM. It's Friday, March the 24th. Hope you can stay with us until 10.
Coming up, we'll be bringing you the big stories making this morning's papers, including new arrests made in the Kerry Babies case.
In sport, Seamus Coleman is a doubt for the Republic of Ireland's crunch clash with France on Monday. And could Johnny Sexton have played his last game for Leinster? We have that and a whole lot more later this hour.
Could the car insurance market be about to get a big shake-up? We'll be finding out later this hour.
And he was one third of everyone's favourite 80s pop sensations, Matt Goss of Bruss, will be telling us about bringing his Vegas show to Ireland.
Now it's over to Kat. What are you up to today?
Good morning, folks. Well, today marks Daffodil Day, and I'll be taking to the streets of Dublin a little bit later to raise vital funds for the Irish Cancer Society. So if you do see me out and about, buy a daffodil off me, won't you? Who could say no to this face, guys?
How could you?
We're going to make lots of money today.
Okay. Impossible.
Such a trusting face. We should put that face on a stamp.
Yeah,
we
definitely.
Should. Okay, let's go over to the Virgin Media News Hub now. Here's Hannah Murphy.
Thanks, Martin, and good morning. Two people have been arrested on suspicion of murder almost 40 years after the discovery of the body of a baby boy in what became known as the Kerry Babies case. In 1984, baby John was found on White Strand in Cahersiveen with significant injuries. An extensive investigation has been taking place since 2018, with Gardaí interviewing hundreds of people to try and establish what happened to the newborn. A man in his 60s and a woman in her 50s were arrested in Munster late yesterday evening. Gardaí are continuing to ask anyone with information to contact them. A decision is due today in the appeal by Graeme Dwyer against his conviction for murder. The former architect is serving a life sentence imposed on him in 2015 after he was convicted of the murder of childcare worker Elaine O'Hara, whose remains were found in the Dublin Mountains 13 months after she went missing. Mobile phone metadata formed an important part of the prosecution case against Dwyer, and he challenged the legislation allowing it to be retained and accessed. The High Court had initially ruled in his favour. That ruling was appealed by the state to the Supreme Court, which referred certain issues to the Court of Justice of the EU. It found that the indiscriminate retention of mobile phone data for use of criminal investigations was a breach of EU law. A decision from the Court of Appeals is expected to be delivered later this morning. Accenture is to cut 400 jobs at its Irish operations. The consulting firm announced yesterday that it's to axe 19,000 jobs worldwide over the next 18 months. It's the latest in a long line of businesses cutting staff, with Indeed, Amazon and Meta among those to make similar announcements in recent days. A three-week Garda recruitment campaign begins today, with the Department of Justice announcing new measures designed to help ensure success among as many applicants as possible. That includes advice on the physical competency test, an earlier commencement of the vetting process and plans for a buddy scheme. And Garda Síochána will have ads targeting possible recruits on TV, radio, newspapers and social media. EU leaders are meeting for a second day in Brussels this morning. Yesterday, discussions focused on banking and Brexit, with talks about the EU's competitiveness and the fallout from the recent global banking crisis, along with rising interest rates. The war in Ukraine was also a dominant topic, with a deal approved to send 1 million rounds of ammunition to help counter the threat posed by Russia. The summit continues today, with other issues on the agenda to include migration and energy. A suspected Iranian-affiliated drone has killed a US contractor and injured five US service members in northeast Syria. A statement from the Pentagon claims the drone struck a facility housing American personnel. President Joe Biden has authorized a precision airstrike in response. Parts of the United States continue to be battered by extreme weather conditions. Strong storms are expected to sweep across southern states today. Meanwhile, California is experiencing strong winds and heavy rainfall due to a powerful Pacific storm.
Severe storms are expected to sweep across much of the American South. The states of Arkansas, Louisiana, and Mississippi are likely to face tornadoes, large hail, and flooding. It comes as devastating weather conditions continue to pound the West. A possible tornado swirled through Montebello in southeast Los Angeles, ripping off roofs and twisting the debris in the air. This was the aftermath for multiple local businesses affected by the violent weather. The tornado came amid a strong Pacific storm, which has been bringing damaging winds and heavy downpour. In some areas, wind gusts reach the speed of over 120 kilometres. With months of snowstorms, rains and flooding, it's been a ferocious winter for the locals. Tanya Royd, Virgin Media News.
There were clashes between police and protesters in Paris as hundreds of thousands of people gathered for more than 200 protests across France yesterday. The demonstrations were against a widely unpopular pension reform that passed in the parliament without a vote. Strikes also upended travel as protesters blocked train stations, ports and the Charles de Gaulle airport in Paris. The Paris metro and public transport in other major cities were also disrupted, while almost a third of flights at Paris Orly Airport were cancelled. The Eiffel Tower and the Versailles Palace were also closed yesterday due to the strikes. And finally, authorities in South Korea say they have returned a zebra to the local zoo after he got loose yesterday. Locals watched on as the young zebra galloped through the streets of Seoul for up to 3 hours. It's not clear how the two-year-old managed to escape his pen, but social media was awash with videos of him running alongside cars and pedestrians. A team had to tranquilise him in order to bring him back to the Children's Grand Park, where vets reportedly say he's in a stable condition following his adventure.
World Athletics has banned transgender women from competing in the female category at international events from March 31st. Sebastian Coe, the governing body's president, said no transgender athlete who'd gone through male puberty would be permitted to compete.
The decision was taken in consultation with a number of stakeholders, as well as a range of other community groups, including trans groups. Let me, if I may, start with the transgender athletes. The majority of those consulted stated that transgender athletes should not be competing in the female category. Many believe there is insufficient evidence that trans women do not retain advantage over biological women.
Ireland head coach Greg McWilliams has named his 23-woman squad for their Six Nations opener against Wales tomorrow. Sive McGrath wins her first ever cap at prop. Maeve Dealey, Aoife Dalton and Natasha Behan are all set to make their Six Nations debuts.
I want to play an exciting brand of rugby. I mean, I hope most coaches would say that. We want to play the game the right way. We want people to see it. There's a group of players that are giving it everything. You know, work rate is important, but the soul of a team is around your defence and how you can compete for one another. And I think that's what goes down to my original point, is you pick the right people, people who deserve to represent a country through their honesty, their humility, their work rate, and hopefully you can see that in our performance. That's probably the most important thing to me. It always has been, and I think it always will be.
And there's live Six Nations action on Virgin Media 2 tomorrow as England take on Scotland. Shane Lowry crashed out at the round robin stage of the WGC Dell Technologies match play. Seamus Power's last 16 hopes are still alive though after he beat Adam Hadwin. Rory McIlroy finished two up on Denny McCarthy for two wins from two. Now let's take an opening look at today's weather.
For car insurance, van insurance, or home insurance. Call the Quote Devil. Unless, of course, you've got money to burn.
This morning will be bright with sunny spells towards the east, but cloudier in the west with patchy, blustery rain becoming more widespread as the morning goes on. Top temperatures of 8 to 10 degrees. This afternoon, rain will continue, turning heavier and potentially thundery falls towards the north and west. Drier towards the south and east with some sunny spells. Top temperatures of 8 to 10 degrees. This evening, showers will be confined to Atlantic counties, with long, dry and clearer spells forming elsewhere. Overnight temperatures of 6 to 7 degrees.
For first-time drivers, young drivers, returning drivers, if you've had an open claim or have had too many penalty points. The Quote Devil's always got one hell of a
quote. Now let's check on your morning paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline, EU agrees ammunition deal for Ukraine. The paper reports that EU leaders agreed last night to jointly purchase 1 million artillery shells and send them to Ukraine over the next year. As Taoiseach Leo Varadkar warned that appeasement has failed and Putin will only stop when we stop him.
Kerry babies, two held on suspicion of murder. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. The paper reporting that a man in his 60s and a woman in her 50s were yesterday arrested in connection with the Kerry babies case.
The Examiner leads with, I never knew that menopause killed my mother. Sally Ann Brady, who lost her mother to suicide during early menopause, spoke at yesterday's National Menopause Summit in Dublin to demand greater supports for menopausal women battling depression.
On to the tabloids and Kerry babies. Man and woman arrested is the top story in the Daily Mail. The paper reports that Gardaí have arrested a man and a woman on suspicion of murdering baby John in a major development in the unsolved Kerry babies case.
The Mirror also goes with that story. Its headline, Two Held Over Kerry Baby's Murder.
And the Sun's front page reads, Kerry Baby's Murder Arrests.
The Star leads with murder arrests in Kerry Baby's probe.
And the Herald goes with, I've to be like this for the rest of my life. The paper reports how Alana Quinn Idris has said the jail time given to one of her attackers does not reflect the life she has lost.
Stay with us. We'll take you through the morning's big stories. That's after the break. ESB, energy prices, etc. Fill us in. The latest controversy hitting the front pages of our papers, John.
Yeah, shock horror. Bumper profits for the ESB last year and a record dividend going to be paid to the state. Obviously, the state majority owners in the ESB, almost three times what it was last year, €326 million. But also story in the paper this morning, and one by Hugh O'Connell in the Irish Independent with regard to the windfall tax and how it is going to operate. And so there's two different parts of the windfall tax. One is sort of a cap and the other is a solidarity charge, essentially. So companies will be allowed to earn, you know, a baseline of their profits from pre-war plus 20%, and anything above that is going to be taxed at 75%. But after lobbying on the government by some people involved in the oil industry, there is going to be a clause in that that will allow companies to basically offset any big capital purchases they've made over the last 5 years, which will mean, obviously, there's less tax for them to pay. They're going to end up contributing less to the pot, which is why I think you see such
a bigger tax write-off for them.
A bigger tax write-off. And some of them were arguing to the government, look, we're not going to be viable if this tax comes in. We've had big expenses over the last few years, and that's essentially why ministers went this way. Also, probably why you see a really big range in the estimates for what this is going to bring in. 200 million to 600 million is a very, very big target to sort of go around. But yes, they've managed to successfully get this tax write down for themselves.
Yeah, but I suppose I'm sorry, I'm a bit cynical when it comes to these sort of things. But basically, the particular article is about fossil fuel companies being lobbied by the owner of Whitegate Oil Refinery in Cork, basically warned the policy could threaten the viability of the plant. And therefore, yes, there are going to be a windfall tax. It's not going to be as great as we previously thought. But where is the windfall tax going to go, and why aren't we getting some of it, and will we be getting some of it, or is it going to disappear into the ether?
Well, I suppose the hope is that they can gather a huge amount of money for that, and it was for the windfall tax, and it was a way of trying to get those who were responsible for fossil fuels, to pay back, you know, towards society and the government having this pot that they can then use, in the, I suppose, the fight against climate change. But I do think it is interesting, like you're saying there, when you see companies like this lobbying, it always makes me think about the fact that, you know, the individual, whether they can lobby the government, and our version of lobbying is either through kind of reporting or through, you know, writing to a newspaper or, you know, going in front of the Leinster House and trying to talk to the government. But actually, meanwhile, you have the people who work for, you know, the oil refineries having a meeting and then actually having a change based on that meeting. I just think who feels like they are listened to by the government. So it's interesting. I mean, they did say in their lobbying, like John was saying, if this goes through and we don't have a way of mitigating some of the cost, it will affect us. And that in turn would affect, obviously, people in
Ireland.
If we
look at the wholesale prices, and I suppose there's a difference here, and the ESB has said there's a difference, the two sides of their business, there's the retail side and there's the generation side. Mm. The generation side is massively profitable. They say the retail side, not so much. But if we look, like, a huge factor in the actual cost of generating electricity is gas prices, which have dropped by 90% since the height of everything else. So this is kind of hugely significant. So I know they're saying, oh, well, really, we can't pass on the savings thus far to the consumer because a lot of people would buy off the ESB grid or other companies, etc. Mm. But it does seem to me that they're, not to generalise too much, but might be taking the you-know-what and not passing on the cuts to us a little bit sooner than we should be seeing them.
I suppose what we don't... Well, the frustration for a lot of people is the prices went up very, very quickly and they're not coming down very, very quickly. They're not going to come down very, very quickly. And what we don't know about the companies is a lot of them buy gas and buy oil ahead of time and they enter into price agreements, and that's what some of them did. They hedged their bets.
But when they put the prices up, they had hedged them as well, and they didn't... They're arguing that we didn't have to put them up. So
this is the thing we don't know. We don't know how long they've hedged. We don't know, did they decide, right, this is going to be a two-year thing, so we're going to hedge for 12 months, or are we going to do it on a three-month basis? And unfortunately, we don't know. We've seen it come down with some, like Electric Ireland, for businesses. You really want to see it coming down for people. But when it comes to the windfall tax, we're not going to see a penny of that until the budget. We're really not going to see any significant intervention again until September, because September is when they're collecting that money.
Now, if we look as well, I suppose on a related note, if we look at the war in Ukraine, Ukraine, the Taoiseach Leo Varadkar has had some very strong words about appeasement compared to Germany in the 30s, related to the policy to Putin, and the news that artillery shells are being purchased by the EU. And I mean, the discussion there, I suppose, is how will it affect Ireland's neutrality? The argument was not, we're not politically neutral, but we're militarily neutral. But as part of the EU, does that wash?
Yeah, it's interesting because I think from day one with the invasion of Ukraine, that's been the message with Ireland that, you know, in terms of our neutrality, like you're saying, we're military neutral, but politically we're not neutral. And I think that's been a really important thing probably for the Irish government in terms of being able to say how they feel about the invasion of Ukraine, and that saying how they feel about it and their stance on it is not saying that, you know, that we're going to affect our neutrality in some way, but also they can stand as part of the EU and kind of agree with some things the EU does, like the sending 1 million artillery shells to Ukraine without actually having to do that, you know, take part in that work itself. I think Sean was saying he was present yesterday when the Taoiseach was making those really strong comments about saying appeasement has failed, really coming out there and basically saying, you know, Putin's not going to stop unless we make him stop. You know, again, maybe it's easy to say that when you are, you know, militarily neutral in a way, because you're leaving that work up to somebody else. But it is, I think, very important, clearly, for him to make those comments. I don't know how you found him at the time.
I sort of found that it didn't sound like a neutral country when he was making the comments. When he said that Putin
would... Sorry to interrupt you, but previously there was talk of sending 30 personnel to train Ukrainian forces. I mean, and we have a precedent to that in the UN. We've sent people to Lebanon, which was technically a war zone then, and aided by the Finnish army, who were also neutral. Their engineers were tackling landmines there. So if they're doing that, technically speaking, it's...
Yeah, you wonder where position. Does it... Like, our neutrality has been stretched by this beyond anything it's been stretched before. And, like, the comments of the Taoiseach didn't sound, as I say, like someone who was leading a neutral country. He was asked, you know, where does Putin stop? And he says, Putin stops where we stop him. Which is not something you expect an Irish Taoiseach to say, and it's getting a lot more involved in a war than I think we've ever been before. And you see some of the comments Micheál Martin when he was Taoiseach as well. There is a direction of travel that seems to suggest that in the 21st century, maybe we can't afford to be neutral anymore.
On a lighter note today, apparently if you listen to bedtime apps, you'll get an extra 30 minutes sleep, which is very welcome for anyone who struggles. Any of you two, you do?
Yeah, I do like an old sleep app. I've listened to one where the guy just has a really, really boring voice, and the whole point is that he just puts you to sleep.
Yeah. Is that me? Is that my reports? Yeah, I listen back to News Talk every day. And
No. This guy's a professional boring voice person. Right. So I've done that and listened to famous people reading stories and stuff. But I think the more you think about sleep, we were saying earlier, the more you think about it, the harder it is to sleep. But it does say that people are less stressed, they have less anxiety if they listen to these apps. They sleep more. There's a lot of money to be made in them as well. There's a lot of celebrities being paid a lot of money to read, you know, really boring stories for the likes of myself and other people.
Like these different frequencies of noise as well. There's a podcast on this recently, the brown noise, white noise, pink noise. Can all set you off to different kinds of sleep. Some which are better for babies. The pink noise is really good for babies, apparently. White noise is better for adults. It's rainfall for me. If I hear rain on the roof, that just knocks me off in 5 minutes.
That wakes me up.
Really?
I'm a light sleeper. Oh. I'll say no more. Thank you very much for joining us today. Now stay with us. We're talking sports after this short break.
Welcome back to Ireland AM. Now, with Revolut joining the world of car insurance, the question on everyone's lips is, how will this affect the Irish market?
Well, joining us now to help us suss out what this may mean is consumer expert Sinead Ryan. How are you doing, Sinead?
Guys, morning.
All right. Now, for the likes of me, who doesn't have Revolut, just what is Revolut?
You're missing out, Mark.
No, it's not. Anybody in my house is Revolut, bar me.
Well, look, Revolut is what's called a fintech disruptor, Martin. So this is it's a digital bank. So it doesn't have branches on the street. It doesn't have a load of staff. It exists kind of digitally. And its banking licence is in Lithuania, but it's EU. It's fully bonded and covered and insured and all that. So it's very, very safe.
It's the future.
It is, but like, there's the mainstream banks that we have now, like AIB and Bank of Ireland and PTSB, like, their product has really come on since a lot of these disruptors ended up. N26 is another one, because they've now realised they have to compete with fancy apps and being allowed to transfer money and share bills and all that kind of stuff that Revolut does. Revolut is absolutely super when it comes to foreign currency. So they don't charge the fees. So, for instance, I was in Budapest earlier in the month. Now, they're not in the euro. So I had to open, I opened up a Hungarian forint account, and they were able to transfer between euro and forint, pay locally. So you're not paying, you know, the fees you get charged every time you buy a cup of coffee or whatever. That's gone. So it's brilliant for that kind of stuff. Now, that said, you've got a query on your account. You can't wander into a branch and ask somebody to help you.
That is the only thing.
No problem. But you need the human contact.
So it's not for everybody, but a lot of people, Martin, will have two accounts. So they'll have their mainstream bank account and they'll have Revolut. So if you're in a taxi on the way home, you know that tight friend you always have that never pays the bill? You can say, here I am, Revolut.
Right, get your phone out, I'm right here. So it is great for that, and it has over 2 million users in Ireland alone, I think.
Accounts.
Yeah,
so,
million
so it doesn't mean that's how many users they have, because some of those would be dormant. Some people have several accounts. So, it's hard to know. But certainly a million. And listen, that's phenomenal. Yeah. You know, it's brilliant.
But now, why are they entering the car insurance market?
Well, listen, banks only make money by selling stuff, by selling money. Mm-hmm. OK, so loans, credit cards, they've already done that. And the next foray is car insurance. All banks sell travel insurance, car insurance. Super Value sells car insurance. Yeah, yeah. But it doesn't mean that they have a whole office of people sitting, you know, working out rates and working out what you drive and where you live and all of that kind of stuff. So they act effectively. It's like it's called a wrap product. They act as a broker for a big insurer like AXA. In Super Value's case, it's AXA or Allianz or whatever. So when they're providing it, what they mean is they're selling it.
Okay. You know, that's kind of how it will work. It'll be a trusted insurance.
We think so. We haven't seen the detail on what's available yet. Yeah. They've opened up what they call a wait list. Now, like, I don't know, I go on a wait list if there's a Beyoncé concert.
Not if I want to.
Me too. Sure. But a wait list that will be, so they obviously think there's going to be a deluge of business. Yeah. And we'll see. We'll wait and see.
Well, they're making a big promise.
Yeah, they are. They're promising that prices will be 30% lower. But here's my question. How will you know?
Exactly.
Yeah, how can they promise that?
So the chances are, I mean, they're entering quite a dysfunctional market, OK? Now, the good news for consumers is there's loads of competition in the car insurance market. Tons, OK? So it's not like we're kind of waiting on a new player to come in. Yeah. But price is always a problem, because we know from old that claims in this country are very high.
Ridiculous.
It has been extraordinary. Lawyers' fees are very high. Now, not as many cases go to court as people think they do. Very few do. Mm-hmm. But the ones that do seem to get massive payouts. Mm-hmm. And you're like, well, if I have a crash and my neck is a bit sore, I'm heading in there too, you know? Yeah. And they have this book, it's called the Book of Quantum. It's a kind of a listing of what a broken arm is worth and what a broken leg is worth and all that. And they quantify it. And they have this all over Europe. Britain has it and Europe has it. But the difference is, in Europe, the Book of Quantum is based on a court deciding an arm is worth 5,000 euro.
Yeah.
So if you break your arm in a crash, that's what you get. End of. Mm-hmm. And it keeps it even for everybody. Mm-hmm. In Ireland, it works on actual awards that have been paid out. So it's much higher.
But we have a claim culture in Ireland that's been in existence for over 40 years.
We do. And there is that accusation. And we've had it before. And until that's tackled. Now, I have to say, good work is being done. And the prices are levelling out in some cases, even beginning to come down. But people still have to be super careful. So whenever you get a new entrant into the market saying, we're going to do things much cheaper, I would ask how.
Yeah.
And the reason will probably be, and as I say, we haven't seen the detail of Revolut's product. What it does have is a massive market, huge buying power, and that means it can do deals for discounts directly with an insurance company.
I was reading this, reading up on this yesterday, and they said they're going to be an app-based only in car insurance. And I do think now with the demographic that that uses Revolut, it is attractive. So do you think they have a leg to stand on there with so much choice in Ireland? Will they make a difference?
Well, look, if you're not paying for offices and paying for staff and paying for people to be on the phone to answer questions, that's absolutely going to be cheaper. No question. However, if you have a dispute or if you have a query or something goes wrong in the app, what do you do next? And people are finding that with these digital banks. There's nobody to phone up, so everything is chat boxes. And listen, you, a lovely young lady, are absolutely brilliant at all that kind of stuff. You'd say, I don't want to talk to people. I can do all
just
this by
just on the app,
Martin, well, you too, of course, lovely young woman. But possibly...
Good
like
say,
me,
Sinead.
Possibly like me, want to phone up or talk
wanna
to talk
sometimes
to
you just want to talk to a human, even I understand that as well, because, like, when you have a query and you're frustrated about something, your question might not be directly answered and you just need another person on the line, you know?
Yeah. Or just when you've reached the end of the line with the chatbot, and you're like, I still have a question. Of course it'll be cheaper to run on an app. Of course it'll be cheaper if there's no branches and staff and all of that. That's fantastic. Yeah. And look, car insurance is one of those products. It's a necessary evil. Mm-hmm. You can't do without it. Mm-hmm. You have to have it if you want to drive. And anything that'll cut costs will help. But I would just remind people that the single biggest thing that is going to cut your cost is not to have penalty points on your licence. That is the minute you get that,
You can get a governor on your car that will make sure that
there's no insurance company is going to do that any cheaper. It depends on your age, where you live, what you drive, and your penalty points. That's it. Mm-hmm. And Revolut or any other bank can't do it any different.
Okay, really. It is going to be interesting. They're not the only one that's coming into the car insurance market. There's somebody else on the way, but we've run out of time, and it's a conversation we'll have another day. Good to see you.
Good to see you too.
Good to see you always.
All right. Still to come, 80s pop superstar Matt Goss tells us about life after Bros.
And later, I'll be in town trying to raise funds for Daffodil Day, so stay with us.
You're watching Ireland AM. A very happy Friday to all who celebrate.
Coming up, with divorce rates hitting a record high, that might be a reason for celebrating for some, certainly after the pandemic, we'll be looking at the do's and don'ts of a clean separation, especially in families with young children.
In fashion, we're taking a closer look at the print styles taking over the high street this spring.
And he's the 80s heartthrob every girl had a poster of in their bedroom, did you?
No. Actually, I did.
But
it was my sister's because I shared a bedroom, so there you go.
All right. Matt Goss of Bros will be chatting to us after nine.
Now, Kat is over in the kitchen with some lovely displays around her.
I am, with all this colour. This is really mood boosting. Well, with Easter only 2 weeks away, we'll be getting quite festive at Florist Joeanna Caffrey. Joanna, what are we making this morning?
So today I'm going to show you how to make a beautiful, simple Easter wreath. Perfect for your hall door or your table at Easter.
Stunning. Yeah. That would definitely make your next door neighbour a bit jealous. It'd make you want to get one, wouldn't
it? Of course. And you can make it from anything you like from your garden. Oh. You know, you don't have to use exactly what I have, but they're very simple.
Now let's check on your morning paper, starting with the Irish Times. Its headline, EU agrees ammunition deal for Ukraine. The paper reports that EU leaders agreed last night to jointly purchase 1 million artillery shells and send them to Ukraine over the next year, as Taoiseach Leo Varadkar warned that appeasement has failed and Putin will only stop where we stop him.
Kerry babies, two held on suspicion of murder. That's the front page of the Irish Independent. The paper reporting that a man in his 60s and a woman in her 50s were yesterday arrested in connection with the Kerry babies case.
The Examiner leads with, I never knew menopause had killed my mother. Sally Ann Brady, who lost her mother to suicide during early menopause, spoke at yesterday's National Menopause Summit in Dublin to demand greater supports for menopausal women battling depression.
Onto the tabloids, and Kerry babies, man and woman arrested, is the top story in the Daily Mail. The paper reports that Gardaí have arrested a man and a woman on suspicion of murdering baby John in a major development in the unsolved Kerry babies case.
The Mirror also goes with that story. Their headline, two held over Kerry babies murder.
And the Sun's front page reads, Kerry babies murder arrest.
The Star leads with murder arrests in Kerry baby's probe.
And the Herald goes with, I have to be like this for the rest of my life. The paper reports how Alana Quinn Idris has said the jail term given to one of her attackers does not reflect the life she has lost.
Now, I have a scary statistic for you. Like last year alone, 44,000 people in Ireland, yes, just Ireland, received a cancer diagnosis. So today marks Daffodil Day, and it's a day to fundraise for the Irish Cancer Society. And I will be going out to town a little later to raise funds and maybe busk a little bit. But just
busk.
Maybe busk, who knows? Well, I'm just saying on the topic of all of this, cancer is something that has touched everyone's lives, whether it has affected a loved one or a loved one's loved one. And just yesterday, a dear friend of mine got the news that her dad was diagnosed with cancer. And it just goes to show, like, in this country, so many people go through it, and that's why an organization like this is so important. And they only receive 3% of their funding from the government, so they heavily rely
on
us.
Days like today.
Both my parents died from cancer, actually, and my father died in March. So when you see daffodils, it always reminds me of his death, and they make me a little bit sad, but I suppose. I don't know, I just remember in and around the time, and it was all, obviously, this is the month that a lot of people think of fundraising for cancer, but it's just, it's scary. Like, it was 22 years ago, but it doesn't seem like yesterday.
But it was just, you never get over.
It's just mad when the statistics are scary. It touches everyone's lives.
Okay, and one of the scary things is, through COVID, because COVID was front and centre, so many people's diagnoses were delayed, or they didn't go to hospital. If they were feeling unwell. And so they're at a later stage by the time they get their diagnosis. So the treatment is far more aggressive.
It's
a big day for the Irish Cancer Society.
But they do such great work.
Oh, it's brilliant.
They do such great work. I mean, God, the amount of, like, I know last week when we had some guests on the show, we were speaking about night nursing and things like that. Yeah. I mean, the support structures are really, really great if you can access them. And it all, as you said, fundraising is so vital, and that's what today's about.
Absolutely. And you said busking. Well, I only say that because I'm meeting with Jackie, who's been fundraising for the Irish Cancer Society for 25 years, and she has the ukulele band called the Walkalalies, and they're going to be on College Green, so I will be right there with them.
Catch a lady.
Yeah, so
will you please sing?
Do you know what? I might sing a song or get my ukulele out.
I'll have to hurry up. Get your skates on, girl.
It's Friday. You know, morning traffic.
You'll know where to find me. That's all I'm going to say. Right, see you guys.
See you later on.
So where are you going to be?
College Green.
With our ukulele.
Catch you later. With my ukulele.
She's got to sing us a song.
Have you requests for Katya that she could sing?
I think she
outside
should,
College Green.
You know,
if you want to send in
all for a good cause.
Songs that you think will sound great on the ukulele or not, let us know. We'd love to hear from you.
It's Katya, not us, don't worry. But after the break, the ultimate guide to still being friends. We'll be getting tips on having an amicable divorce. That's after the break.
Welcome back. Now, with divorce rates in Ireland hitting a record high post-pandemic, couples across Ireland are heading into court without really knowing what to expect.
Joining us now with the do's and don'ts of modern divorce is family mediator Michelle Browne. Michelle, thank you so much for joining us on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
It's lovely to see you. Now, I suppose when we think of divorce, I mean, it's a relatively new phenomenon in Ireland considering comparing to other European countries in the States, etc. But post-pandemic, I suppose there was a delay in processing. A lot of people lived together and realised 24/7 it exposed cracks in relationships that didn't exist. So there is a bit of a spike. But tell us the difference between going straight to kind of divorce lawyers, etc., and mediators, which is what you do. What is mediation?
Yeah. OK, well, first part of what you've stated, yes, divorce is on the increase.
Yeah.
Has it been? It's been around 25 years. Mm. I suppose it was pointed out recently, my generation is probably the first in a large mass that have been queuing up for the courts for divorce. So it's around 25 years. We're processing applications in fairly much the same way. And it's kind of been highlighted, I suppose, because of the amount and the queues over more recent years, how ineffective the traditional court system is. Mm-hmm. So I suppose, you know, that's what's been highlighted through the increases with COVID. And, you know, There was queues, to be honest with you. There was queues beforehand. Yeah. There always has been this problem.
In the court system in general, anyway.
System in general. But the difference being, with family court, there are children involved. There are different kind of emotions involved. If you know anybody who's dealing with a court case, it's tough enough. Mm. But whereby it's on the back of a breakdown of a marriage, it's a grief in parts. It's one way it's described, the breakdown of a marriage, worrying about finances, worrying about the future for your children.
So getting into court makes it all that more stressful. So where does mediation come in?
The process of getting it into force is lengthy and costly, hugely costly and lengthy. And people feel that it's going to deal with issues that it just doesn't. It's ill-effective. So, look, mediation, thankfully, is on the increase and people have become more aware of what mediation is. Still, it's not enough. We need more support from the government as to what mediation is. The biggest deterrent to mediation working is the fact that the court system is there and people are frustrated and they want to go there. But, sorry.
No, I was just saying that the mediation has changed because there was a time when if you were separating, you might be encouraged to go and speak to somebody who could mediate between the two parties, but it would still go into the hands of solicitors and through the courts, whereas now you don't have to go to the courts if you go through mediation.
Absolutely, and that's what's wonderful about it. The Mediation Act was 2017. Yeah. It started 2018 to roll out an ability for your family mediator to deal with a separation for you.
So what is a family mediator? I think it's important we describe what that is.
A family mediator is an independent third party who works with both parties in the best interest of your children first and then yourselves. So your mediator will see you both together or separately. Now, this is something people say, I can't mediate, I can't talk to them, I can't sit in the same room as them. Mediation will work with both parties. It is not essential for you to be in the same room. If somebody is capable of having a conversation, they're capable of having an agreement mediated. Now, there's more involved in the process than that, but people feel if it's acrimonious, it's not going to work. It is by far and large the better way to deal with this. The courts are not giving people what they want. People are hurt and angry and frustrated and going to the courts, and it's not achieving what they wanted to achieve.
It could be that much more adversarial, I think, if it goes as far as the courts.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And, it exacerbates it every single time. If you can imagine yourself and Martin break up and instead of sitting down and deciding, a letter pops through the post. Mm. Before you know it, there's a response and the response gets more heated and communication breaks down. Mm-hmm. And when communication breaks down and there's children in the middle, our children are affected.
Yeah.
We need to decide to do something differently. First of all, as a society, and second of all, we want a bit of help from the government support. And it's not rocket science, you know?
Well, you see, what happens is when letters start changing hands like this, that's normally at a point where solicitors have become involved.
Absolutely.
So you're talking about how parents, especially where kids are concerned, must be speaking so that because children have to be front and centre in these situations and thought of first before anything else. But sometimes couples will start to believe that, well, the solicitor's involved, so I can't contact them.
Correct.
And the solicitors want that situation.
I would like to think it's a process rather than individuals to blame for this. But the process has been that you engage the solicitor and this, and people then are in an awful state when they can't get hold of their solicitor and they want to discuss the pickup or drop off, and the communication is so bad that they can't, and then they can't get hold of their solicitor. So look, it's a horrible system to get in, and the people that are hurt are the children and the wider families for that matter. Mm. So obviously people need to know more about mediation. We need, as a society, to say, I'm not going to take my spouse through that court system. I was actually reading in yesterday's paper, the UK have decided to make mediation mandatory or for to try it for a period of time.
Is that the answer?
That, I believe, is a must for families with children to prevent what's going on at the moment. Yeah. It would drastically reduce the number of the queues in the courts, and it would really help. Now,
so is there a group people can get in touch with? Because we're going to have people watching this show going, I've heard of mediation a little bit. It's all very... Well, I know where my solicitor is. I know where I can get someone on the high street like that. But is there a body? Is there an association? Or is there a place people can get more information on this?
Absolutely. Well, look, you can get in contact with Brown & Co Mediation. We're in Nace beside the courthouse. But there are mediators the length and breadth of the country. And there are organisations such as the MII, Mediators Institute of Ireland, and IPMO, Irish Professional Mediators Organisation. They are, you know, supporting... Yeah. Mediators throughout the country.
And you came to this through bitter experience, really.
I did.
Yeah. You were divorced. You've been divorced twice, is that right?
I have gone through the process twice.
And so you know exactly what it can take.
I have inadvertently become an expert in the area without ever intending to. And to be honest with you, they were experiences that I would not wish on my worst enemy. And, you know... I don't say that lightly. It is hugely traumatising for the parties and the children. So I am in a great position to understand and to empathise with people.
So you know exactly
what
you're talking about when it comes to this. And thank you so much for joining us today.
Good to see you.
No problem. Thanks for having me.
All right.
Now, stay with us with more Ireland AM after this short break.
Welcome back. Easter is around the corner and the shops are full of festive decorations for your house. But we thought we'd have a go at making our own. Now, when we said we, the producers thought that we'd have a go.
Yeah. Making easy of ourselves once again. But to help us, Florist Joeanna Caffrey is here to show us how we can make the perfect Easter wreath. Yes, wreaths are not just for Christmas, apparently. Not at all.
No.
They're popular all around the year, be it Halloween, Easter, Christmas. We love them all the time.
Yes, all year round now. They're becoming more popular all the time.
Yeah. But I suppose when it comes to Christmas and Halloween, you kind of use more maybe autumnal preserve, things like holly, etc. We're focusing on fresh flowers, fresh cuttings here.
Fresh cuttings here. So fresh greenery and then the flowers of your choice, whatever you decide to use. And you can pick things from your garden or things you see naturally growing. It's actually the best way to do it.
Or buy them. Don't go taking them out of parks because that's against the law. Right?
Yeah. No, don't go doing that.
Don't. Please.
So these, all the ones we're seeing now in front of us, they'd be pretty much in season now. We could see them in our gardens if we have little pieces sprouting all over the place.
Well, some things like this clematis is from my garden.
Yeah.
And the eucalyptus is actually from my garden.
Yeah.
But the other things are from my shop sort of over.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Lovely. Right, so I suppose we start. So this is the first thing. We're looking at this. So tell us about this bad boy.
This is an oasis. It's a small wreath, a 10-inch wreath. Our goal is to get the wreath looking like this at the end.
Okay, so if we take a moment for this. So that's what we need to look like at the end.
At the end.
Yes.
All right.
But this is what it looks like at the beginning.
Okay. Where do we get one of these?
So you can get this in any of your local florists. We sell them in our shops too. If you don't have this, you could use an old Christmas wreath and put greenery and flowers in. The only thing is they won't be drinking water, so it won't last the same. So this is great because this is water-soaked.
Now, it's wet. How long do you soak it for?
So it's dry when you buy it. You turn it upside down in a basin of water. You don't push it. Yeah. Any oasis you're working with, you don't push it. You let it soak down naturally. Writing first. Mm-hmm. And then it'll take like maybe 30 seconds for it to...
Is that all?
Yeah. Is that all? Okay, yeah. I thought we were leaving it overnight.
Sorry, soaking it like a dookie beans or something. But no. So start.
I'm going to start with So I've added my ribbon. You can add any ribbon you like or twine.
The ribbon is
mine's already on a work to room.
So this
tip
will
the floor.
Hang on your door like so.
Okay.
So then you take you do your greenery first. I have salal here, or you could use ivy. And you go all the one direction and you start at the base.
Oh, right.
Like
okay.
So you go the whole way around. You want to be covering your mechanics the whole time. So you don't want to ever see the plastic of the oasis.
Okay.
Oh, good luck, Grace.
Or any of the mechanics of your floral arrangement.
You never
want
to see.
And you've got to go clockwise.
I mean, like the plastic or the kind
clockwise,
of plastic
anti-clockwise. Is it?
Anti-clockwise, clockwise. It doesn't matter as long as you go in the same direction.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So we got one direction and oasis. So two reunions
line
going
there.
On.
Yeah. Okay. Then I do start at the top as well.
But you need to, obviously you need to shove the stems in a little bit. Now the greenery, I suppose, would last a bit longer, wouldn't it?
The greenery will last. Could last months if this is outside, and you can change your flowers then.
Oh, I didn't even think of that. That's a great idea.
You can change your flowers out.
And it's nice actually. You get the lovely smell of the eucalyptus as well there.
Yes.
Oh, are you already on your eucalyptus?
I'm not on my eucalyptus. I'm not. Don't be ridiculous.
So there's my base, and you don't want to fill it too much because you need to leave room for your flowers.
Okay. So is that enough there?
There's my base of salal. Yes. And now you'd go into the top now.
Okay.
Top. Here. So that's your base.
I need more salal.
Oh, oops. No problem. Oh,
jeez. So far ahead of me.
There's a little bit more than you might. So that's your base. And now I'm going to start on my eucalyptus.
Okay.
So a little bit of eucalyptus in. And you always make sure that the greenery is not on the line that you're going to put into the oasis, because you'll create huge holes in your oasis and your flowers will fall out then.
Okay.
So you want to make sure your greenery is stripped.
Okay.
Do you know what? This could be something you could do with your kids.
Yes, my daughter Violet.
What great fun. Who's
watching this morning?
Hello,
Violet. Hi, Violet. Oh, my God.
Your daddy, Paul.
Oh, my God. What a lovely name, Violet. My first name is Rose, would you believe?
Is it?
Yeah.
Oh, my aunt's name.
Do you have any roses? Oh, no.
No, we do. Some over there. We've got some lovely pink roses.
So my little Violet loves flowers. Every day she says, have you brought me home flowers, Mummy? And she's only almost three.
What are the most popular ones at this time of year? Obviously, today being Daffodil Day as well. I mean,
well,
we see them everywhere.
I adore daffodils.
Yeah.
They are difficult in oasis. I thought about using them today because they've
they
very soft
die very
stem.
Quickly, don't they?
Well, they wouldn't so much in water. Just their stem is quite soft. So that's my base of greenery there. That's my greenery done, pretty much.
Right, okay.
You've started on the flowers already.
Martin?
I'm just trying to get ahead
of
everybody.
Your dab hand.
Well, so I don't know if I'm a dab hand. I'm just...
My greenery base. And now I'm going to start go with my hydrangeas. And you would go flower by flower.
Okay.
So generally, I would do a group of flowers, then my next, then my next. And you'll go in odd numbers, so threes or fives. So I'm going to pop my hydrangea in like so.
There.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to do three.
There.
Yeah, I'm not going to tell you what the producer just said. Yeah, I'm completely
There's
wrong
my
here.
There's three hydrangeas. Hydrangeas are very temperamental. They love water, so you would split the stem, which I did just before we started. Mm-hmm. And then you'd add your roses in. I've got five roses. And you can use any flower you like, as I said.
Any flower we want.
Yeah, or you could just do all greenery, which would be lovely too. So there's your roses in.
I'm doing great, apparently.
You're doing great.
Oh, yeah,
going
to the top of the class.
Now I'm
going to
do freesias.
Oh, I love freesias.
Forsythia
is
growing everywhere.
This is quite therapeutic, lads.
Yes.
This is...
It is. It's a lovely thing to
do. What's next?
Freesias.
Oh, freesias, sorry.
Well, you can do the clematis if you like. Freesias. These also smell really nice. Mm. And the colour yellow is lovely for Easter.
Isn't it? Yellow always cheers me up. My
so that's your freesias in. Now I've got viburnum. These pretty ones.
We've only got a minute left, lads.
1 minute.
I feel as if
so
I've been transported
done.
Back to the generation game,
we're
lads.
We're almost done.
Yeah.
Your viburnum in.
Good game, good game.
Then I have the clematis. Which is from my garden.
No, I don't know where this is going to stick, but it's going in somewhere.
You could, if you wanted to use daffodils, you actually could use a plant and wire it into the arrangement.
Yeah.
Or you could wire the stems, but they're not great in oasis. But I do love daffodils. They're all over my house, and tulips also.
No.
So that's really, and you can add in greenery if you have any gaps.
No, we have, there's your eggs.
So then I have a grouping of eggs. I deconstruct it in Easter. I do, yeah.
Oh.
Because if
one second,
a birdie laid their eggs, they'd all be together.
Do you know what? I'm really delighted.
But you could also use chocolates.
That you've included one of these, lads, because everybody thinks that you know these that birds are solely for wintertime. No, they're not.
And that's it there, the little bird in with her little eggs, mm-hmm. ready to hatch. Or you could even paint eggs and put them in with your kids.
Oh, that's a good idea, actually, for Easter.
Kids would love this.
They would.
Uh-oh, my robin's fallen down. My robin's drunk.
There's a little clip.
Oh, yeah, no, I have the clip on it. It's still falling down.
So that's it, really. Yeah.
Me board's pissed.
No. There we go.
Definitely.
There you are. Beautiful job, beautiful job.
I'm missing a bit of greenery.
You can be at home now making your wreaths all season, all year round.
No.
Jenny will be delighted with you, Mark.
I think she'll be very happy. Okay.
Not so sure about mine.
You've done a beautiful job.
The top of mine's looking a bit wonky.
No, it's lovely. And you could just fill in the gaps now.
I need another
greenery.
Bit of...
Yeah, just fill in. In other words, we're not...
Yeah, right, OK.
Joanne, this is brilliant.
Thank you so much, Joanne. Thank you so much. These are lovely.
Yes, you've done a lovely job.
I missed an egg
honestly,
up here, but that's
honestly,
lovely.
No. This studio has never been so quiet.
Yeah. We're concentrating, lads. Concentrate. Thank
focus.
You so much. I feel very
You're
much
welcome.
Educated.
Joanne, great idea. Easter wreaths. Centrepiece or on your door?
A centrepiece, you could put a candle in the centre.
The stress of
or
that!
Or on your door.
Thank you
It'll
so
work.
Much.
It's not stressful, it's nice.
Now, after the break, I'm leaving here and hitting the catwalk. We're showing Spring Prince. That's next.
Here, wear this on your head.
Yes.
fans, we've the ultimate rugby prize. Win two tickets to Ireland versus Scotland at the Rugby World Cup in Paris, plus flights and transfers with 3 nights stay in a 4-star hotel. And a brand new Samsung S23 Ultra to capture it all. The power to play is in the palm of your hand with Virgin Mobile. Our best price Free Spirit Unlimited plan is exclusive to Virgin Media customers and gives you the freedom to move with a 30-day contract. Virgin Mobile. It's playtime.
You're very welcome back and thanks for staying with us. In fashion today, we're focusing on print and the latest ways to wear them this spring. Stylist Judy Gilroy joins us. Good morning. Thank you very much for joining us today.
Good morning.
There's a stretch in the evenings. We just had lovely Easter wreath. Spring has sprung and the fashion is matching.
Oh, yes, it has. A new season of fashion is coming through. So today we are taking a look at prints for spring, some of the key prints to know about and how you can style them. Because I think that people can be a little bit afraid to print sometimes. Times, but they're actually quite easy to wear.
Yeah, we're starting a subtle enough print. We're going florals first.
Exactly. I mean, we always say florals for spring, groundbreaking. But there's a reason that florals come back every single year, and it's because that they're so easy to wear and they're so versatile. So our first look today on Sophie is this beautiful ditzy floral number. And this is so sweet and feminine and just a great look for springtime. Now, one of the reasons I love this print in this way is because you can take a dress like this, which is from the Casual company, and you can either dress it up or you can dress it down, and there's lots of different ways you can wear it. So our dress today is from the Casual company. All the prices are going to be online today for social media. We're seeing it there, €49, super value. This dress ticks all the boxes for me. It's got the fab V neckline. It's got the cinched in sleeves, the cinched in waist. So you've got that amazing silhouette, but this is a really comfortable dress as well. So today I've picked up on those ditzy floral vibes and I've gone ultra feminine with the jewellery. I've got beautiful pieces from Absolute Jewellery, which is another Irish brand. It's stocked in over 200 stockists throughout Ireland, so you'll be able to find it easily. And we've just gone for those beautiful pieces there in the pink and the rose gold, which really pick up on the lovely pink tones.
Handy
in our
bag
dress
there as well.
It is, it's cute. I mean, we're really seeing the mini tote bag coming in as a real hero trend piece this year. Our bag and all of our shoes today are from Cinder's Shoes, which you can shop online. And then to polish off the look there, these shoes are just fabulous. I've gone for the little pop colour there on our shoes. Bright pink, $49.95. I think these are going to be a great buy this season to lift Magenta. Any outfit. Exactly.
Kind of a mix of Barbie core and the colour of the year with Pantone, so we're hitting all the marks.
Who
today
doesn't love it?
I love this. Now it's a really cool, crisp look. But we'll start with the shirt here, and that is accenting the florals.
A great example of, if you don't want to go head-to-toe print, how you can kind of dip into prints more as an accent, taking a white suit and really mixing it up. So this look today is from Nicola Ross, which you can shop online at nicolaross.ie. This is by a brand, a fab Irish brand called Kate and Pippa. So our top is $39.99. I've gone for it in the lilac colourway because it's just such a soft, beautiful colour and it's really on trend this year, but this does come in a couple of different colours if purple isn't your thing. So I have mixed that in. I've gone for some really classic pieces of jewellery here today from Absolute Jewellery. This look, I suppose I was really inspired by the fact that people are really going to have a lot of communions and confirmations and occasions coming up, and I thought that this look was bang on the money for it. So the suit itself is also from Nicola Ross. Our blazer is $139.99 and our trousers are $69.99. Now what I like about this is you're buying them separately, so if you want to go for like a bigger size in the trousers and a smaller size in the blazer, you can do that because we're not all uniform from head to toe, and it's really important when you're buying a suit to really get it to fit you well. So then for our handbag and for our shoes, I've kept it really classic, really simple, going for that classic shoulder bag. And then the little kind of square toe pump, which I think is really sweet. These are $69.95 from Cinder Shoes.
And they look very comfortable, I have to say.
They do. And do you know, this shape shoe is really in at the moment. Really? We're seeing a lot of it. Yeah, that real classic style.
The spindly stilettos are on the way out.
They are. God. And do you know, they're comfortable.
And we're more of a nautical look now. Stripes, if you're going for a print, stripes are always good.
You can't go wrong with the stripe, can you? So stripes for spring, or any season for that matter, are always in style. And our t-shirt today is from The Casual Company. It's €26. And do you know, The Casual Company do amazing casual pieces, really good basics like this t-shirt and the trousers that you can wear and wash a lot. And they cover a big size range as well. So you're covered right from size 6 up to size 20, which I always think is fantastic. The daytime look like this, I always say not to forget to accessorise. I've put in a little pop of colour there, not just in the handbag, but in the bracelet and the earrings there, and those kind of turquoise tones. So the thing about stripes when you're going for that black and white monochrome look is you want to bring it to life with those colours in our bracelet and in our handbag, adding in that pop of colour and that crossbody bag there from Cinder Shoes. So handy, keeping your hands free when you're running around. These trousers from The Casual Company, €39. They've got an elasticated waist, and they're kind of like a cross between a palazzo pant and a tracksuit bottom, which I love.
They're just so handy for the summer as well.
They really are nice and light, and pop on a pair of trainers and you're good to go.
Thank you so much. And finally, what print have you for our final piece today?
So, do you know what? I think that people always think about animal print as a winter print, but it's really not at all.
Some coral and pink.
Yeah, so this is a take on the animal print, and this look here today is from Nicola Ross. You can shop it online at nicolaross.ie. Again, this one's by Kate and Pippa. So this is €99. I love this dress because I think the print is fab. It's going to turn loads of heads. But again, this dress is super versatile. You can wear this dressed up. I've styled it kind of for an occasion with all the glitzy pieces of jewellery. I've gone for like the real chunky gold pieces of jewellery in the necklace and in the bracelet. But equally, you could put this with a pair of like brown summer sandals during hot weather and wear this on holidays as well. So there's loads of different ways to wear this dress. So we're getting a look there at our lovely sparkly bag here. So I kind of had a wedding or occasion in mind for this look.
And it does dress it up when you have a little bit of bling.
Yeah, but like pop on a denim jacket and a pair of trainers and you can.
But we're not doing trainers here.
We are not.
Some lovely sparkles.
We are going all out, some sparkles. And that platform style again is a real hero style this year. And our shoes are from Cinder's Shoes.
I think you've excelled yourself today. Much to choose from in terms of not just your usual floral prints. We've got
exactly.
Animal print and everything else. Thank you so much for joining us today, Judy. And still to come, 80s heartthrob Matt Goss will be joining us, and Kat will make it to the streets of Dublin to raise funds for Daffodil Day. Will she? Won't she? I don't know. We'll find out. She's in a cab as we speak anyway. We'll be catching up with her later. Stay with us. We're live until 10. Welcome back to Ireland AM. Our next guest was one half of the most famous pop group in the 80s, together with Craig Logan and his twin brother Luke. Matt Goss sold 10 million albums, had countless number ones, and still are the youngest men to ever headline Wembley Stadium.
They also knocked themselves off number one with their next single.
Stuff dreams are
bonker
made of.
Bonker stuff. Before we chat to Matt, let's go back down memory lane and remind ourselves of some of Bross's biggest hits. Yes, and all of a sudden we wanted white leather jackets and red jackets, but he hasn't got one on him today. Matt Goss, welcome to the show. How are you?
So lovely to be here.
Oh, it's great to see you again. I mean, that was a wild time. And what people probably don't know is that you were a member of Blue before you were Bross.
Was that true?
Yeah, it was not one of the names you had in one of the bands that you were involved with.
No, I was. It was just Bros Summer House before Bros, and then we then 17 years old. Got our record deal, and no, it was just Bros.
It was just Bros. Okay, but you say Wikipedia fires. Yeah. Get rid of it.
Never to rely on Wikipedia. Anyway,
apparently, I'm also 5'11". I'm 6'2". In Wikipedia, I'm 5'11". Just so you know.
Now, going back to where your music started, I mean, we all know when you exploded onto the stage on screen on Bros. But where did your love of music come from in the first place?
My Aunt Sally introduced me to the best music, Stevie Wonder, Donny Hathaway. My grandfather loved Sinatra. My father and my mother were in a pop band when they were young. Nobody in my family actually managed to make it through, but a very, very musical family. And growing up in Southeast London and Camberwell with my grandfather making roast dinners and with my brother and my mum, and just, it was a very soulful house, you know, full of music. That was a common denominator in our family.
Okay, so with that much music around you, how do they react when you said, actually, you know what, Mum, we're going to go with this music thing and try and make a living from it?
Terrified, absolutely terrified. And the aspirations of us being doctors and lawyers went out the window, but we just love music. And I think my mum had the wisdom to spot that we really, really were not going to give up. We just really loved music, and we were multi-instrumentalists. We didn't audition. We were a band since we were 12, had our first band. And then we were discovered by Sounds magazine, and then later on the Pet Shop Boys manager, Tom Watkins, who then discovered us. And it was just, you know, no looking back.
It's interesting you say that, because when we look at a lot of boy bands, they're quite manufactured, and you say you were together from such a young age. How did you meet? Were you all in school together, and who decided who was doing what in the band?
We did meet in school. We all grew up together. We had multiple bands, terrible names like Caviar. We didn't know what caviar was. We just knew it was expensive. And then we found out it was fish eggs. We were like, let's knock that one on the head. And we then basically, you know, Luke, my brother Luke, was holding an audition for a singer for the band, for a new band, and nobody turned up except me. So by default, I got the gig. Thanks, Luke, for giving me the gig, you know.
So what was the sibling rivalry like then?
I think being the front man of a band like I am, I didn't realize the pitfalls of in regards to being family. But you know, it's a never ending apology. But I'm really proud of being the front man of Bros. We're still together in that way, but I also love having the freedom and to have the agility in the studio and on stage to do, you know, to have my own musical kind of journey.
Yeah, but before we move on to talk about that musical journey that you've made, like, you guys just took off. It was like a bullet from a gun. It was incredible, to the point where your fans were Brossettes. Beatlemania, forget it. We had Brossmania. It really took off, and massive crowds turning up to your album launch.
Yeah, we had 10,000 people outside HMV in Oxford Street, and then I remember we got off the plane, or we were on the plane in Australia, and the captain asked everybody to stay on the plane, and I thought, oh no, somebody's stolen something on the plane, and then it was because we had also around 12,000 people in Sydney Airport. And it's strange growing up as a simple Southeast London boy, and you go to places like Japan, Australia, Malaysia, and all of Europe. Every single country we had the same experience. And I think that's really what you, when you're a kid, you want to be in that kind of band. So I think Bros was an incredible experience. You know, I think sometimes when you're screamed at, people assume you're null and void of musical ability. But I think, you know, it's been a journey. Bros has had its highs and lows, and had certain impactful moments for me as a singer and as an entertainer along the way. But in overall, it's been a really beautiful, beautiful thing to be part of.
Talk to me about Wembley Stadium, because to this day, am I right in saying that you're the youngest to ever headline Wembley?
Yeah, we are, and it's one of those things that are beautiful to have under your belt. That's one of those shows that stays within you when you're having a nervous moment, or just before stage or TV or whatever you're doing. I'm recently sang for President Joe Biden, and you're like, okay, I'm singing for the President of the United States. And you go, well, play Wembley Stadium. You know, it's one of those things that stay in your DNA. It's a really beautiful reminder that you can achieve anything, because everybody when we were growing up said, oh, you know, you'll never amount to anything. You just have to stay single-minded and humble and be grateful for the whole lot.
Yeah, it was an incredible time for you. But since then, of course, you've gone on, like you said, on this solo journey, which took you firstly to LA and then to Las Vegas.
Yeah, I was lucky enough. It took me to New York first. I played venues, Carnegie Hall. I played with the Tokyo String Quartet within Carnegie Hall, Madison Square Gardens. I lived in New York. It was an incredible experience. Worked with some of the greatest people. And then I moved to LA, and then, as you say, Vegas. And 11 years later, I believe I have the longest British residency in Vegas history now. So 11 years is 4 shows a week, 120 shows a year. I've learned so much in Vegas about not just as an entertainer, but composure as a man. You know, it was a really, really educational kind of a journey in Vegas.
I have to say, I love that big band sound. I love all the instruments, all the razzmatazz, the energy that comes from the big band. But how did you go from a pop sensation to what is a different genre of music, really?
I think like anyone watching right now, you know, we love music when we're growing up. I mean, I have influences of Terry Hall, Specials in my big band sound. And, you know, I actually do a moment of like homage to the Specials. But you develop as a man, you know, you develop as a songwriter, and you actually have the courage to actually be influenced and let those come through. And when you're working with a big band, 15-piece big band, and the Royal Philharmonic together, which I just played the Royal Albert Hall, is one of the most beautiful shows of my life. There's so much power that comes with the majesty of an orchestra, and then you put that side alongside a big band. It's what dreams are made of for a musician. And I really understand my craft now. It's taken a lot of courage to say that out loud, but I really know what I'm doing. And when I'm on stage in my tuxedo, and I love it. I just love the power, and I love the connection that I can form with my audience. It's a little bit boozy. I gave a few drinks out. Apparently, the Royal Albert Hall doesn't serve tequila. So we found the next best thing, and I handed that a few out. And we just had a really good time. On stage on Wednesday.
When you're talking about music like this, and you're talking about you getting into your tuxedo, there is a bit of a dress code when it comes to a night like that. You want to look smart. You want to be dolled up to the nines. Not everybody shows up. You know, somebody from NSYNC might show up wearing a pair of shorts and need to be put back in their box.
Yeah, Joey Fatone turned up to one of my shows. I mean, many people, Statham has turned up with his dad, you know, 3 times, and Sharon Stone, loads of people come to my show. But when Joey came to my show, he was wearing shorts, and I just went on probably the whole show about his hairy knees. And he was just like, Matt, if I ever come again, I give you my word, I'm getting putting a suit on. There's not a dress code. It's just bring your version of fabulous. I just want people to have a good night out, a boozy night out, full of connection. I just want to be one of the world's optimists. And even when things are tough, I just want to give people the best night out. And in Vegas, what was brilliant, a learning curve for me, many of people that came to my show were not fans of Matt Goss. It was just like, well, you know, entertain us, you know, and that's exactly what I tried to do. And that's a great thing for me, because I'm like, I'm going to get you. You know, and then sure enough, they had a great night. I take great pride in lifting people's spirits.
Yeah, well, when I go see you now, when you're in the Bord Gáis Energy Theatre, I'm going to wear long trousers so you won't be slagging my hairy knees.
Do you have hairy knees?
I have hairy everything, man. I'm the missing link I am. But tell us, what can we be expecting from the Bord Gáis? I believe Cole Porter is a strong influence on that, that performance that we should be expecting.
I think that everyone from Burt Bacharach to Cole Porter to many other writers, just I think you should shine light on other songwriters, and that I feel that as an obligation as a songwriter myself. And just, you know, I just get to play some of the most beautiful songs ever written, plus a lot of my hits, I think Famous and stuff like that, transformed into that big band style. It's very bluesy, very soulful. It's a beautiful night out. I'm very proud of it.
I'm looking forward to seeing you in that. Thank you so much for joining us on the show this morning. It's been lovely chatting to you.
Cheers, Matt.
Thank you for much. To you.
And of course, Matt will be performing at the Bord Gáis Energy Theatre on the 16th of April. Tickets are available on bordgáisenergytheatre.ie.
Now, what goes on first, the cream or the jam?
Jam.
Jam. Really? No, let's find out. It's one of life's great mysteries that we may get an answer to, because we're making scones after this quick break.
Lots of parents will know the pain of finding new foods for their fussy eating kids. But if there is one certainty in life, is that nobody can say no to a scone.
Joining us now with the recipe for all the family is fussy eating expert and chef Louise Lennox. Thank you so much for joining us today.
It's lovely to be back because I get a bit of peace in here because I've no kids or school drop-offs. But scones, so these are one of my all-time favourite recipes in the world for all of my years of baking. If you ask me what I love, scones with clotted cream and homemade jam is my favourite. But then when I went over to the States and did all of my studying into fussy eating, I was amazed of how important messy play is, and you get that through baking. So this is an amazing recipe, and anyone that can't bake, this is the ultimate recipe because I've tasted a lot of scones, and it's so simple. These are store cupboards. You probably have the ingredients at home. So it's just self-raising flour. Simple little bowl, and then you put in butter. Now, when I say messy play with kids, so when kids are fussy eating, a lot of the time there is some sensory problems there. So they mightn't like even the touch of wetness or stickiness on their hands. So there's a few things to combat that, and I'm talking from experience as well, because my son, although on my baking, never wanted to bake with me, hated it. And he didn't like getting his hands actually sticky, dirty and sticky. So what I would say, this is what I did with him, is you can use a fork, you can put this in a food processor if you want and get them to put the butter in, get them to cut the butter, or you can get plastic gloves. Some kids that are very sensitive to that use a plastic glove or have a damp cloth beside it, because you'd be amazed. We all think some kids love baking and a lot of kids actually don't. But it also reduces pressure and anxiety from kids, because when we're trying to get them to eat food, I'm just putting some sugar there. When we're trying to get them to eat food, there's a lot of pressure at mealtimes. Whereas baking, you're moved from the table and there's not this force of eat the food. It's like, let's experience this enjoyment together.
Now, if I remember from my home economics classes, the butter has to be very, very cold.
It does.
Yes.
But from many years of making this, Elaine, if you're doing this in food processor, go a bit slushy, I have found that rubbing it in even at a bit of room temperature, like, it's actually fine. Bringing in the...
breadcrumbs.
I'm
getting flashbacks.
And that's actually the first thing I learned to make in home economics was scones. But it actually, for scones, does make a difference. If you're making pastry, huge difference. Because your pastry would shrink and it wouldn't be good. But scones actually fine. I've noticed that.
A bit of wiggle room.
So I did already do this in the breadcrumbs. That's nice and dry. And then what I'm going to do is add in an egg. Again, some kids, like my little girl's too, and she hates the feeling of wet egg on her hands. So we made loads of scrambled eggs lately, and we did a lot of cracking eggs, and she went from not touching it to you're desensitizing them, so you're getting them a little bit used to it. And then just goes a little drop of milk, and then very simple, you just break it up. And the beauty about these scones is you can make it any type of flavor you want. Now, I like plain scones. Don't like anything in my scones, and I hate fruit and scones. Now, I know some people love fruit and scones.
They're offended if it's not plain. But if there's fruit in there, I'll still eat it.
Well, this is a great tip, because if you've got kids that are very averse to it, because I was, and I actually like fresh apple chopped into it. That's nice, dry texture. I used to find the fruit in it really dry. And as you can see here, this is like really, really dry. It's like my face light moisturiser in the morning. They're cranberries, because I prefer cranberries to raspberries. But I soaked them in a little bit of cranberry juice, apple juice. You can put in coconut water, whatever you like, even regular water, tea, the list goes on. But this actually makes them really, really soft and supple. And when you bake them, they don't take the moisture away from the scones. You're actually adding moisture back into it. And they stay nice and plump and they don't go bitter. But you can play around with different flavours. Again, with fussy eating
kids. I like savoury scones.
Do you like savoury scones? I don't know how I feel about those yet. My friend went for posh afternoon tea and they'd homemade butter of all different flavours and savoury scones. But you can do them, and it's a great way, again, for getting kids into touching different vegetables. They can grate them. With moisture content, I would say if you're grating in some, say, carrot, or if it's courgettes, dry it off beforehand, because that can have a lot of moisture in it, which can affect the actual overall scone.
Okay. And cutting it. No one wants a soggy scone.
No.
How are you about the cranberries going in? You OK?
Yeah, good.
You're good?
No fear in that.
And then, they're superfood.
Do you make a well, or you just throw the egg in?
Do you know what? I used to make a well, and now I'm just happy if I can get scones made, because it's very busy in my house in the morning. I was trying to make these this morning, so I got up at 5:30 this morning, I'm going to feed the crew, I'm going to feed the gallery, I'm going to feed everyone in Virgin Media. And then Lottie Bow tells me, she goes, what are you making? And she's like picking her nose. She's like, can I help? I was like, oh my God, leave me alone this morning. So anything that goes in that I can make is fine, but it's a luxury these days. And then bring it together. One thing people make wrong when they're making scones is they overwork the mixture. See, I'm kind of lightly
handling this, and my poor rings are going to get destroyed now. And you don't want to overwork because you're going to produce gluten, and too much gluten in a scone is what makes it really, really, really dense. Now, I've got two great tips here. So kids love cutting out stuff. If they're a little bit averse to touching, as I said, any kind of dried fruit, they're touching this and not realising, because when you sit them at the table, a lot of them have the fears, if I have this food in front of me, I'm going to be forced to eat it. When I'm baking, I'm just having fun. And let them have that little bit of messy play. Some of my friends have beautiful big kitchens and they're scared of getting their kids in it messy. My kitchen is like so much fun. I'm like, just let them make a mess.
Kitchens are for cleaning.
They are. Well, mine's never cleaned. And cooking.
And cleaning.
Now you see this. Look, I want to show people. So if you don't have loads of equipment at home, this is a small scone cutter. You can use this to cut it out, but you can also use anything else. Sometimes you can use, look, I've used a fork here.
Use the fork. Use your hands,
pull them apart. You don't have to be too precious. Scones are very forgiving. So use a cutter. If you don't have a cutter, use a fork, use a knife.
Nan used to make the triangular.
Yeah, I should just cut them like that. And even brown soda bread do the same thing.
Yeah,
it's nice.
So I did the cranberry ones in the triangle. And then I kept back a little bit of egg wash just for the tops to give them a little bit of glaze. These cook in 12 to 15 minutes. I'm all about fast bakes for kids. There's not a lot of steps. A lot of kids don't have a lot of concentration for it. So it's quickly made and the payoff is really fast. And I give a smaller amount of this in my recipe because scones have to be eaten the same day. The next day scones are just, they're never as nice. Now, have to back up to this recipe.
How long do they go in the oven for and what
12 to 15 minutes in a fan oven. I say between 75 and 80 degrees, because 180, because everyone's oven's fast or slow.
Yeah.
Now, homemade strawberry jam. I didn't have time to make this, so it's up on my Instagram. I did the recipe and the video. I'd even edited it last night to make it easy. But the beauty about homemade strawberry jam, Lane, I've given you a little bit there, is the fact that it's got more fruit and less sugar. In most shop-bought ones, they have more sugar to fruit, or they'll tell you there's more fruit. And when you read the ingredients on the back, they actually bulk it out with apple juice so they can technically say there's more fruit in it, which there is, but there's still more sugar flavour, whereas
so
this is more fruit.
You're a jam first.
I'm a jam. Oh, yeah. I don't know if you're cream or not, but you're cream now, Martin. So
well,
I'm giving you a cranberry scone.
All right. And thank you very much.
If you're making strawberry jam, like I use frozen strawberries because they're always in season in my freezer.
Mm. Don't the Americans call scones biscuits?
They do.
Why?
I got confused. I ordered stew one time and they put like biscuits on top of it. I was like, scones on top of a stew? That's strange.
Don't even
like
talk to me about chips. Anyway, say no more.
Yeah, I did ask for chips once in America and I got a bag of crisps.
Yeah, there you go. This is absolutely delicious.
Love
it. Oh, and the recipe for my jam is on my Instagram. And I've lots of fussy eating tips on there as well. I've gotten a little bit better with social media.
Okay. So bacon, always good for kids. Thanks, Louise. Full recipe details, by the way, are on our website, as always. Or you can follow Louise on Instagram. Just search for @LouiseLennox.
So did Kat make it into Dublin City Centre to take part in Daffodil Day? Well, I think,
we'll be finding out after the
break.
Welcome back. Last year alone, 44,000 people in Ireland received a cancer diagnosis. Today marks Daffodil Day, and with one in two of us getting a cancer diagnosis in our lifetime, we thought we'd hit the streets to support this amazing cause. I'm here with CEO of the Irish Cancer Society, April Power, and Jackie Byrne, member of the Wakalele's Ukulele Band here behind me and fundraiser for 25 years. Good morning, guys. Welcome to Ireland, AM. You're very, very welcome here. Delighted the sun has come out today on Daffodil Day. But Jackie, 25 years, and we're actually in the area where it all started for you. You started fundraising
right here.
Tell me, what does day mean to you?
This day is so special. The sun is shining, makes it extra special. All my friends in the Wakalele's are here, and the wonderful, generous Irish public are out there. That's what brings me back every year.
Yeah.
The generosity overwhelms me, it really does. And it's such a fun day, and people even just stopping by to say, hi, great, don't need a flower, just want to make a donation.
Oh, yeah.
I'm telling you, it moves me. The first couple of years, I went home in tears.
I know.
But now I've got better and like,
It's a lovely community. And even for yourself, talk to us about your own personal experience with cancer.
Well, I started in 98. I don't have, me personally, my mum was diagnosed in 98 with breast cancer. And I just heard the call on the radio. And I worked in that big institution over there, Trinity College. So I thought, I could do 2 hours.
Yeah.
And I rang up and I came here for 2 hours and then I was hooked. My mum survived cancer. My sister is in that group behind us playing, who is 18
in remission from cancer.
Wow.
I count myself so lucky.
Yeah.
My family are just so lucky that I have two. And I just can't say enough about the Cancer Society, the support we got as a family along the way. So anything I can do, I'm there.
Absolutely. And April, you know, everyone in this country has been touched by cancer, whether it's a loved one or a loved one's loved one. So for those who don't know about Daffodil Day, tell us, what is Daffodil Day?
Well, Daffodil Day is the day when volunteers all across Ireland, like Jackie and her amazing team here, come together to raise vital funds for cancer research and services and to give hope to people in their community going through cancer. I just think it's just such a show of solidarity. It's lovely when you walk down the street, particularly if you're someone who's going through cancer right now, to see people wearing Daffodil pins, to know that your friends, your neighbours care.
We're in
and
this
that they're
together.
Behind you.
Yeah.
And that we're all in this together.
Absolutely. And, you know, surely there is government funding involved. So tell us, why is it still important to support and donate?
Well, we only get 3% of our funding from the state, so we have to raise over 26 million euro every year to fund all of our life-saving research, our nursing services, counseling, hospital transport, all the other free services that we offer.
Yeah.
So we really are so dependent on Daffodil Day. We just, you know, without Daffodil Day, we can't be there for the people that need us.
Absolutely.
And we really want to make sure that nobody in Ireland has to go through cancer alone.
Absolutely. And for those who can't physically buy a Daffodil today, how can we support?
There are loads of ways to support us. If we're out in person, please, you know, drop along, have a chat with one of our volunteers, buy a Daffodil pin or a lunchbox. We've got bottles.
We've got a whole shop.
We've tea towels. We've all kinds of stuff. Go on cancer.ie.
Yeah.
Or, you know, on Revolut. There's so many different ways for people to get behind us. And every euro, honestly, means so much to a child or adult with cancer in your community.
Absolutely.
It means so much to them to know that you care and that you're helping us invest in research so that more and more people survive the disease. I think that's the really important thing, you know?
Absolutely.
And I'm sure you've probably seen the effects and of all of the support from Daffodil Day and like that in action for families.
Absolutely. And then I've had friends, obviously, who've had cancer, and I always say, bring the Cancer Society. There's always someone at the end of the phone.
Mm-hmm.
And I've noticed in hospitals, the Daffodil little centres within the foyers of hospitals, there's always someone to talk to.
That's vitally important.
Yeah.
And the money like that we fundraise on a day like today, what does that go towards?
So it funds the services that Jackie mentioned. We have nurses based in each of the hospitals who help people who've just had a diagnosis figure out what they're going to be facing. We have night nurses who care for people at home, counsellors, free transport services to bring you to and from the hospital, and really importantly, life-saving research. You know, when we first started Daffodil Day, only 3 out of 10 Irish people survived a cancer diagnosis. Today, 6 in 10 do,
which is amazing, right?
None of us, you know, the ukuleles, Jackie, myself, our nurses, none of us will give up until 10 out of 10 people do.
Absolutely.
But we need the money to do that, right? There are amazing things happening in the research community. We can't fund everything that we would like to, and we really want to be able to do more, because the more we raise, the faster we can turn today's terminal cancers into tomorrow's treatable and survivable ones. And that's the hope that Daffodil Day is all about.
And I'm sure it does feel great to be out, especially going through the pandemic. A lot of people who did receive a diagnosis after, you know, received it quite late and are going through more aggressive treatment. So it is also solidarity to them, people who have been struggling the last 2 years.
Getting a cancer diagnosis is awful at any time, but over the last few years, because of COVID, we've had people hear those words alone.
Yeah.
Who didn't have a loved one beside them, anybody to hold their hand. People who've been isolated in hospital, parents of young children who've been in hospital for months without being able to see their kids. Like, it's just been such an isolating and really upsetting experience.
Yeah.
And as a result of that, we're seeing that, you know, demand for our counselling services has increased dramatically because of that distress. So it really means a lot to people, you know, after all of that.
Absolutely.
To see things like this and that hope again.
And you know what, they sound great. If you're on College Green, make sure you stop by and get a bit of this. And I'm sure all of the donation information is up on the screen. It's back over to you in the studio, Elena Martin.
Thanks, Catherine.
Oh, thank you so much. That was absolutely amazing. And do you know what? The buzz around that would be so fantastic.
Absolutely. And as you go about your business today, no matter where you're going, you're going to come across people who are collecting for the Irish Cancer Society. And as we said, lots of people touched by it. It's got a rippling effect. So donate whatever you can.
now coming up tomorrow. She's had busy weekend since joining the Ant and Dec Saturday Night Takeaway team, but she's putting down her sacks to chat to us. Fleur East will be joining us.
Strictly Come Dancing's professional dancer Diane Buswell will be telling us how we can move ourselves happy.
And as the clocks go forward this weekend, we'll be showing you how to make your spring the season of slumber.
All that plus the new sport and weather that you're waking up to. We're back in the morning from 9. Getting set for a night with 1 hour's less sleep.
When is it less? Oh, yeah. I thought it was more.
No, spring forward. Anyway, plenty of text in. Well, it would always be a jam and then cream, but it has to be clotted cream if it's available, says Casey.
I'm not fussy. Normal cream, clotted cream, butter, on brand. Harking back to my home ec days, I think it was the first thing I learned to make as a teen. That's Susan, we were talking about scones there a little earlier on.
And as we were saying at the end, I worked at a camp in the States for my J1. There was stew and biscuits for dinner. They were scones, not biscuits. I still don't understand it, says Hayley. Neither do we.
All kinds of wrong. All kinds of wrong. See you tomorrow. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.